A Pokémon's cry is the sound it uses to identify itself. In the more recent games, each cry is unique, and it's easy to tell them apart from one another. However, in the first generation games, Pokémon Red, Blue, and Green, the way cries were implemented was very limiting. This resulted in a lot of Pokémon having very similar cries. And a couple of them even have the exact same cry. This video will aim to explain everything about Pokémon cries in this generation of games, including how they are stored, how they are assigned to Pokémon, and how they are played by the Game Boy system. Before diving directly into the sound effects themselves, we should familiarize ourselves with the sound engine the Game Boy uses a bit first. The Game Boy's audio processing system has four channels in total, two pulse channels, a wave channel, and a noise channel. The pulse channels output square waves at a specified frequency and volume. They can produce these waveforms with four different duty cycles, 12.5%, 25%, 50%, and 75%. While both channels have built-in volume sweeping capabilities, only the first pulse channel has built-in frequency sweeping options. Both the sweeping period, how often the frequency is adjusted, and the sweep rate, how much the frequency is adjusted by, can be set. The wave channel outputs a waveform that corresponds to the PCM data in the wavetable memory mapped to addresses FF30 through FF3F. Each of the 16 bytes corresponds to two 4-bit signed values. The result is 32 samples that are used to build the waveform. The channel has frequency and volume settings, but no built-in sweeping options. And finally, the noise channel outputs pseudo-white noise at a specified pulling frequency and volume. It has built-in volume sweeping, just like the pulse channels. The noise is generated from a linear feedback shift register, which can be set to 7 bits or 15 bits in length. All channels have a length counter that controls the maximum length of a note before it terminates on its own, and a switch to turn this feature on or off. And of course, each channel has a trigger bit that will initiate the channel's sound when it is set to 1. How these sound channels are controlled specifically will be explained in a moment when we look at the Pokémon cry format. To simplify things for this video, we will only show the properties that are used when producing the cry sound effects. The length counters are disabled, and pulse frequency sweeping isn't utilized, and the entire wave channel is unused for these purposes. Now let's look at how the cry data is stored in the ROM. The sound effect is broken into three lists of commands, one list for each channel. There are five different commands that are used: set duty cycle pattern, play a pulse note, play a noise note, loop, and end channel. The duty cycle pattern and pulse note are specific to the pulse channels, and the noise note is specific to the noise channel. The loop and end channel commands can show up on any of the channels. Let's look at the commands one by one. Set duty cycle pattern. This command's opcode is hex FC, and it has a single byte operand that specifies which duty cycle to use for the following notes. All notes after this command will use this duty cycle pattern until another one of these commands changes it. There are only four duty cycles. So how are the entire 8 bits of this operand used? If we listen to waveforms that use each of these duty cycles, you can hear that they are very smooth sounding. In order to get a more lively sounding note, the duty can be changed in the middle of the note. It sounds kind of disorienting until the cycle is changed extremely quickly. Then the note starts to have a fuller sound and is much more interesting to listen to. So to utilize this, the duty cycle pattern command contains four duty cycles to use, each of them is swapped out very quickly. Of course, if a simple non-alternating duty cycle pattern is desired, the pattern can just specify the same duty 4 times. This increases the amount of waveform shapes from 4 to 70. Play a pulse note. This command has opcodes hex 20 through 2F, and the entire command is 4 bytes long. The lower half of the opcode actually specifies the length of the note in frames minus 1, ranging from 1 to 16. Once a note has been playing for the number of frames specified, the next note is played. If there are no more notes, the last one will keep continuing to play until the volume is swept to 0. During this release period, the duty cycle is not updated. This causes the channel to taper off smoothly. The second byte of the command controls the volume and the volume sweep. It goes directly into the register that controls the audio channel. The upper half is the initial volume from 0 to 15. The bottom half is a signed 4-bit number that controls the direction and the speed of the volume sweep. Positive numbers make the note get quieter over time, 0 makes it stay the same, and negative numbers make it get louder. A smaller magnitude will make the note change volume quicker, and a higher magnitude will make it change slower. The last 2 bytes contain the frequency value that is supplied to the sound engine. The actual frequency that is played is determined by this formula. Due to the inverse nature of this function, the musical pitch of the note is somewhat exponential instead of logarithmic. This means a small change in a low value hardly changes the pitch, but a small change in a high value can change the pitch a lot. Play a noise note. This command is identical to the pulse note command, but it is used by the noise channel instead. The only difference is that instead of a 16-bit frequency value, an 8-bit noise parameter is supplied instead. Bit 3 is used to control the length of the LFSR, 15 bits when clear and 7 bits when set. The other 7 bits are used to control the frequency at which it is sampled using this formula. Each time the LFSR is sampled, the output is just the inverse of the single lowest bit in the register. This is then adjusted by the current volume of the noise channel. Then, the entire register is shifted right once. The new bit 0 and the previous bit 0 are exclusive ORed together, and the result is put at the 15th bit, and also the 7th bit, depending on the current length setting. This will produce a pseudo-random output, resulting in a noise that sort of sounds like old TV static. A register length of 7 bits will repeat more often than that of 15 bits. So a 7-bit LFSR will produce a sharper, more metallic noise. Loop. This command has the opcode hex FE, and it has an 8-bit operand and a 16-bit operand. The first byte specifies the number of times this segment will be played. This counts the first playthrough before hitting the command, so a value of 2 will only loop once, resulting in it playing 2 times total. The second operand is a pointer to cry sound effect data to jump back to when this command is reached. The amount of loops taken currently is stored internally, and once the number matches what the command said, the loop command is skipped to move on to the next part. This command is useful for compressing sound and song data, especially when the same rhythm is played many times over. End channel. This command is pretty self-explanatory. It has opcode hex FF and no operands. Once the channel reaches this command, it will halt and stop playing for this sound effect. As a quick example, here is a list of commands for the first pulse channel for one of the cries. The first opcode is hex FC, so it is a duty cycle pattern command. The 88 in hex would correspond to a pattern of 2020, which alternates between 12.5% duty and 50% duty. The next 6 commands are all note commands. They last for 6, 10, 6, 10, 6, and 7 frames respectively. You can also calculate each note's volume, volume fade, and frequency values from the rest of the operands. This command has opcode hex FE, so it's a loop command. The first 2 here shows that it will play twice, so it will only jump back one time. This 16-bit pointer is pointing back to the very start of the data, so the entire thing will be replayed. And finally, the channel will be silenced due to the hex FF channel terminator. This is what this data would sound like. And again, a little slower, so you can follow along. Alright, now that we understand how the cry sound effects are stored and played, let's look at how the Pokémon actually utilize these cries. It is not uncommon knowledge that Charizard and Rhyhorn have the same cry, and that Poliwag and Ditto share a cry as well. How did this happen? In fact, even though these are the only 2 exact pairs, many of them sound very similar. The answer is that there are only 38 cry sound effects. Each Pokémon uses one of these 38 base cry sound effects, and then pitch shifts and/or time stretches them in order to make unique cries. Here are the 38 groups. You'll notice that a lot of evolutionary families use the same base cry, so their cries sound somewhat similar. The claim is that Pokémon in the same group just pitch shift and/or time stretch the same base cry, but listen to Metapod and Ghastly. Clearly, there is something else going on, since these 2 sound quite different. Let's look at how exactly pitch shifting and time stretching are implemented. Pitch shifting is pretty straightforward, but there are a few caveats that affect the end result. The pitch shift value goes from 0 to 255, with 0 being no shift, and 255 being the most shifted pitch upwards. This value is directly added to the frequency value to get the new frequency value. Remember, this frequency value is exponentially related to the actual frequency of the sound, so higher pitches get shifted more than lower ones. In addition to this, the frequency value is limited to 11 bits. If adding the pitch shift value to the frequency value results in a value larger than 2047, it overflows back to a really low value. This can result in a pitch shift resulting in a lower sound than a higher one. This exact method is used for pitch shifting the noise channel as well. The pitch shift value is added directly to the entire parameter byte, and it overflows at 255. Because the parameters are stored in the order they are, a constant increase in shifted pitch results in a wild sawtooth-like decreasing noise pitch, alternating between the 2 LFSR lengths. Combine this with the fact that the number of bits used for this parameter is the same as the number of bits used for the pitch shift value, each noise note effectively gets a scrambled frequency. One last thing to mention about the noise channel is that the pitch shift effect is cancelled after both pulse channels are done playing notes. The current pitch shift value is erased from memory when the sound effect finishes, but the noise channel itself isn't checked. So once the last pulse channel reaches the release mode for its final note, the remainder of the noise channel's notes will revert to the original parameters. This is actually noticeable in a handful of Pokémon cries, as they end with a grumble or crash that isn't present in the first part of the cry, like Doduo, or Drowsy. Time-stretching cries is somewhat difficult when the sound effect engine only runs once per frame. This means notes can only start and end on frame boundaries, which is about once every 16.7 milliseconds. It is worth pointing out first that time stretching is only applied to the pulse channels and not the noise channel. Since the pulse channels will end earlier or later than default, this can affect when the noise channel's pitch shifting is canceled. Playing a cry faster will result in more ending noise variants, and playing it slower will potentially eliminate it. For example, you just heard Drowsy's cry end in a crashing sound, but Executor's does not, since it plays the cry slower. And the pulse channels continue to play while the noise channel finishes. Anyway, in order to shorten or extend the sound effect, each note's length is multiplied by a constant. With no time stretch, this constant is 256, which is hex 100. The upper 8 bits will be the number of frames this note will be held for, and the lower 8 bits are stored as fractional frames that add into the calculation for the next note. Since the fractional bit will always be 0 for a note that isn't stretched, this value can be ignored. However, this multiplier constant can vary from hex 80 to 17F. When there is a remainder left over that represents fractional frames, this amount is added to the next note after the multiplier constant is applied. This means that for very small time stretches, the resulting sound effect can sound exactly the same as the original. The resolution at which the notes can be updated is just too coarse for these subtle effects to be realized. This method does work fine for larger time stretches, though. The range of this time stretch effect goes from playing the cry up to 2 times as fast, or up to 1.5 times longer than the original. Before concluding this video, I would like to share a small web app I created that lets you explore all of the Pokemon Cry sound effects and mess around with them. You can find a link to it in the video description. It lets you play back all 151 Pokemon cries, as well as specify your own pitch shift and time stretch parameters to create unused cries. You can mute and play back each channel individually in order to focus on one channel at a time. And finally, if you're feeling really ambitious, you can specify your own commands to create entirely new sounds. This video will conclude with a few examples of Pokemon cries with all of the visual aids shown so far. Shortly, another video will be released that shows all 151 first generation Pokemon for reference. Thank you for watching. You